così per salvarle.
The narrow lanes of Murano are lined with memories for Lino Tagliapietra. Around every corner lies a story, a familiar house or restaurant, or an old acquaintance to greet. Murano, tiny islands crisscrossed by bridges, is just across the lagoon from Venice and a world apart. Little did Tagliapietra know as a boy growing up in this working-class world that he would one day be an artist, let alone an artist many consider to be the greatest glassblower in history. Nor could he have seen that his journey would take him across continents, cultures, oceans, decades, and bring him full circle back to these 8 square kilometers of home. Like glass itself, Lino's life has taken shape in surprising and extraordinary ways. It has been a story of continuously working, constantly in motion, responding to what presents itself, hot, in the moment. Willing it into something original. A life, a legacy, a masterpiece.
Credo che la laguna che ho giocato tantissimo là e mi ha veramente affascinato e mi è rimasta nei ricordi come una delle cose più belle che della vita. Accompagnavo mio zio da piccolo, che faceva le barche, ed era molto bello. Cioè...
Lino Tagliapietra was born on Murano in 1934. The sounds of water and the roar of glass furnaces filled his ears. That's because tiny Murano was, from the 13th century on, the epicenter for blowing glass. Early on, the Venetians had established themselves as masters of the craft. Everyday glass containers, goblets, glass beads, all traveled from Italy to the world. But the secrets of glass production stayed in Venice. These were closely guarded traditions passed on from one master to the next. And the punishment for leaking them was severe. Of course, a city made of wood, even one surrounded by water, is always vulnerable to fire. And in 1291, the Venetian state ordered that all furnaces, artisans, and glass blowing operations move to Murano, a series of small islands dotting the lagoon a mile to the north. That way, not only could the risk of fire be contained, the secrets of blowing glass could be kept even more under wraps. By the time Lino was born, many major glass workshops thrived on Murano, in an area spanning less than a square mile.
Il ricordo più intenso che ho del vetro di quando da bambino stavo giocando a calcio. Giocavamo con pallone fatto di carta. Era ancora in corso la guerra. E attraverso una porta semiaperta vidi un signore che stava soffiando il vetro. Mi fermai a guardarlo, come in trance, fino a che il pezzo non fu finito. Dove visti, dopo averli visti lavorare su pezzi bellissimi, mi ricordo che mi trovai a pensare: anch'io voglio fare questo nella mia vita.
At 10. He left school to begin work in a factory making utility glass.
Mia mamma non voleva che lavorassi il vetro, anzi, non ha mai voluto. Perché ero troppo piccolo, troppo magro, troppo così. Proprio quando andavo a lavorare era sempre molto triste, così. Non è un mestiere per te. Anche quando sono diventato maestro, anche importante, mia mamma mi ha sempre detto: non è un mestiere, te l'ho sempre detto. Tu hai voluto fare di testa tua.
But Lino was hooked, and at age 12, he began work for Archimede Seguso, one of Murano's oldest and most esteemed glass families.
Sono andato allora da Archimede e lui mi ha detto in fabbrica lì: mettiti qua, lavora qua. E con quel maestro sono rimasto 9 anni. È stato un po' scioccante, però ho avuto il mio primo stipendio, 250 lire. In fondo erano 25 cents alla settimana. È stato bello. E lì è iniziato, ho imparato a lavorare al vetro. È stata un'esperienza difficile perché si faceva molta produzione al tempo e si lavorava anche a cottimo, però vetro soffiato. Gli orari di lavoro erano 7, dalle 7 mattina alle 5 del pomeriggio e poi nei periodi dopo si lavorava dalle 5 di mattina alle 7 di sera. Cioè si facevano praticamente 2 ore di cottimo, 9 ore di lavoro e 2 ore di cottimo, perché c'era da lavorare. È stato un periodo lungo di apprendistato che ha servito. Ho dei bei ricordi, ma anche di brutti, insomma. Però è stato, sai, quando si dice devi soffrire, in realtà io ho sofferto quel periodo. Anche se cercavi in qualche modo di reagire in qualche modo. E poi sei cresciuto dalla pubertà all'adulto in fabbrica e non è stato bello.
At Archimede Seguso, Lino worked in a team organized around a glass-blowing bench, a work group known as a piazza. But in the hierarchical world of the factory, it would take years and a little bit of luck for an apprentice to move up the ranks.
Ho fatto tanti errori. Senza errori non si impara. Ero diventato bravissimo a fare il zanfirico, la preparazione nel stesso tempo. Mi ricordo che facevo le teste di figurine, i cappelli, le maschere, tutto quello che mi serviva di accessori per gli altri praticamente, o piccole cose per me. Nel frattempo cominciavo a fare qualche bicchiere, qualcosina, intanto per crescere. Però c'era un però che sulla lista della fabbrica, che era un forno rotondo, e c'era il nome dei colori. Cioè una fabbrica, c'era per esempio qui c'era Gino, c'era il verde, Gino verde, Gigetto blu, Aldo cristallo, d'oro, normali, Opalin, Dante, Nane. Dove ero io c'era una X. E cominciavo dopo 5, 6, 7 mesi, no? E tutte le mattine andavo in fabbrica e andavo a vedere e c'era sempre questa X, no? È passato, tanto passa questi mesi. Finalmente una mattina trovo il mio Lino Brosso e sei, hai gare. E là è stata veramente una svolta molto importante, molto molto importante. Poi nella vita è così, però sì, anche adesso quando sbaglio vedo che quando hai l'opportunità di capire che stai, che hai fatto un gradino, ecco, che non sei proprio in mezzo così, ma sei appoggiato e vai. Quello è un segno molto importante. Vivere a Venezia e vivere con un museo a cielo aperto, e pertanto con un po' di occhi aperti, un po' di curiosità, cioè ti arricchisci anche se non vuoi, ecco, lo senti dentro questo, ecco. Venezia ti dà questa enorme opportunità, perché i colori variano secondo il tempo, le stagioni, è incredibile, insomma, cioè è veramente incredibile. Città è un museo.
Meanwhile, inspiration for the young artist was everywhere, in the city's rich past, and in modern art too. As the Venice Biennale brought artists like Mark Rothko, Henry Moore, and Lucio Fontana.
La Biennale per me è sempre stata personalmente un esempio di cultura, un esempio di divulgazione culturale, di arricchimento culturale. Rothko lo ricordo, mi ricordo gli italiani Fontana, ero innamorato di Burri, innamorato di Henry Moore. La passione era Lucio Fontana per qualche motivo, però mi ricordo l'influenza, cioè l'eccitazione che ti dava una giornata alla Biennale, cioè se si tornava due o tre volte. La Biennale per me è veramente è qualcosa di speciale. Credo mi sono arricchito da quello che ho visto e anche inconsciamente che non ho visto. Però la Biennale è stato per me, diciamo, una scuola molto, ma molto importante, molto importante.
Eventually, Lino left Seguso to go to work as an assistant for Galliano Ferro, where he had to adapt to new ways of working.
Galliano Ferro è stato veramente un periodo di, per me, di grande competizione, ma con me stesso. Con me stesso perché venivo da una esperienza di lavoro con l'Archimede Seguso che era di un stile completamente diverso. Con la Galliano Ferro era proprio di tradizionale classico muranese e di più per lampadari, chandelier, lampadari, che io non avevo mai fatto, mai lavorato proprio come assistente. Io ho dovuto imparare in fretta. E l'ho imparato, è stato molto difficile. Mi sono impegnato tantissimo, tantissimo veramente. Cioè andavo 2 ore prima e 1 ora dopo e anche il mezzogiorno e ho capito che era il momento di svolta della mia vita, dovevo imparare. E l'ho fatto. Però è stato molto difficile, molto impegnativo. Dovevo farlo. Ho capito che non ero un genio.
In Nano Ferro, Lino had found a mentor and a master whom he credits with shaping the course of his life.
Nano Ferro era molto religioso. Prima di lavorare qualche volta si pregava. Abbiamo il santino, pregava. Perché era il... Però lui mi ha veramente insegnato molto. Mi ha insegnato a non avere fretta. Che potevo lavorare adesso, se non lo facevo oggi, avrei fatto domani. E così è stato, mi ha veramente aiutato tantissimo, sia tecnicamente ma anche filosoficamente. Una persona eccezionale. Senza di lui probabilmente non sarei diventato maestro.
His time at Galliano Ferro was one of intense focus and dedication. As Tagliapietra immersed himself in learning both the science of glassmaking, heat efficiencies, chemical composition, and the art of blowing objects in the intricate Venetian style. Lino's dedication did not go unnoticed in Ferro's factory, and as his technique and skills grew, he was offered the opportunity to step up.
Se non c'era il suo aiuto filosofico, e anche umano, mai e poi mai sarei diventato maestro. Senza di lui, io non mi sentivo pronto. Non mi sento mai pronto per la verità, ma non mi sentivo pronto in modo più assoluto. Però lui mi ha spinto ad accettare. Lui mi ha spinto ad accettare e mi ha aiutato a continuare.
At age 21, Tagliapietra was acknowledged as a maestrino, one step below maestro, the highest level of accomplishment in the glass-blowing world. Soon after, by consensus from the other masters at Ferro and Ferro himself, Lino was declared maestro.
You hear the term maestro a lot less than I think one would in the past. And when one hears maestro, they often think the leader of a symphony over here in the United States. But maestro was the title of the master sitting at the bench who was running the team of glassblowers.
Okay.
Glassblowing is typically done in a team of 2 up to maybe 15 people for a very complicated piece. And the maestro was the person that's calling the shots and sitting at the bench finishing the piece. Lino attained the title of maestro at the age of 21. At 21 years old, he already had 10 years of experience as a glassblower, which was an incredibly young age to do that, and a pretty big deal for him to be leading his own team of glassblowers.
The new master went to work daily, just as he had for half of his young life, in a world that was hot, demanding, and rough. Days in these un-air-conditioned factories were long. Workers were paid by the piece. And glassblowers, even the maestros, did not typically develop their own designs. They were expected to execute the signature pieces of the factory. Meanwhile, outside of this man's world at work, Lino had met a young woman who captured his heart. Lina Ongaro was the daughter of a prominent Murano family whose brother, Checco Ongaro, was himself a renowned glassmaster. Lino used to take Lina to the cinema with strict orders to have her home by 10:30, which meant missing the end of almost every film. But the end for the couple was happy, for in 1959, Lino and Lina were married.
Maritare Nina è stata la fortuna della mia vita e credo che probabilmente senza Lina sarei stato un po' strano, ecco, come perché apparente sono calmo, tranquillo, però ho delle pulsioni molto strane, per esempio come vorrei fare 100.000 cose nel stesso tempo. My father-in-law liked me a lot after many years. He told me a very nice story. You know, quando tu hai sposato Lina, eravamo preoccupati perché non sapevamo se tu eri in grado di diventare un bravo maestro. Invece mio suocero era per me un grande uomo e mi voleva anche bene, insomma. E quando che abbiamo parlato qualche volta e lui mi ha detto, veramente, lui mi ha detto non mai avremmo pensato che tu saresti diventato così bravo. E adesso che posso dirtelo, sei diventato il migliore. Sei, oh my God, sei wow. My father-in-law, my Italo, signor Italo. I call him signor Italo. Signor Italo mi ha detto questo. È stato un orgoglio che mai arto, you know? Me che mi credi assolutamente. Una grande persona, grande mosaicista, e veramente mi ha quello mi ha molto commosso. E lui era veramente critico, ma in modo veramente positivo, in modo buono.
Family, Tagliapietra worked hard to establish his professional career. First at Vanini, a venerated glass shop. Then as co-artistic director of La Murina, and later as artistic director for Effetre International. But in 1979, life took an unexpected and, as it turns out, an amazing turn. Lino's brother-in-law, Checco Ongaro, recommended him for a summer teaching position in America. And the extraordinary second chapter of Lino's career began.
And the taxi driver said, where do you want to go? I go to Pilchak. Where is Pilchak? Stanford.
One of the things we did early on, we wanted to invite the greatest glass artists and craftsmen as we could. Because my philosophy was, if you have great teachers, a great artist, you're going to have great students. The students will follow you. And there were others before that. But when you think of Pilchuck, you think a lot about Lino Tagliapietra, probably the best glassblower in the world. So when we had the likes of Lino, there wasn't anybody in the whole world that wouldn't want to be around him. You know, you want to learn how to blow glass, you'd stick around.
At Pilchuck, Tagliapietra didn't need to speak English. The language was glass, and it was clear that the master was in the house.
Lino came in 79, and we were all, like, our eyes were working overtime. We were amazed at his skill level, and he used, at that time, joked that we looked like we were working with ceramics because we worked the glass so cold, and he worked it so hot, but of course none of us had the skill level to work it as hot as he did.
Speed and intuition with which Lino worked, second nature for a maestro from Murano, amazed the young crowd at Pilchuck. Self-admitted hippies, they were used to a more loose, anything-goes style of blowing glass. Lino upped the game, technique-wise. Watching him gather the hot glass, observing his rhythm, his use of tools, Lino conveyed unspoken information with every move back and forth to the glory hole, and the students paid close attention, eager to learn every new trick. The process of blowing glass is a magical one. In the roaring furnace, at temperatures of 1700 degrees Celsius, silica sand, soda ash, and limestone liquefy into a river of molten glass. A glass blower reaches into the furnace with a hollow steel tube to gather a fiery mass onto the pipe, continuously turning it so that the material grows steadily and evenly.
What's unique about glass compared to other things, perhaps? Imagine some little kid coming into the glass shop and you take a blowpipe and you roll some honey around the end and bring it out and blow a bubble. Now, if that's not unique, I don't know what is.
Once the glass is sufficiently gathered, it is taken to a steel table called a marva to be rolled and shaped into a symmetrical cylinder. Next, the artist blows into the pipe to send a bubble down the tube. Then, it's back to the furnace to gather more glass, shaping, blowing, rolling, adding color, constantly working and moving. Jacks, or long tongs, are used to cut in a score line on the neck of the piece. And finally, the piece is cracked off from the rod and placed in an annealer to cool. One of the classic intricate Venetian techniques Tagliapietra demonstrated for students was how to work with canes. These are long, thin rods of colored glass that are made by stretching the molten material like saltwater taffy across a series of wooden ladders laid out on the glass-blowing floor. Once elongated to pencil-like thinness, these glass rods are cut into smaller identical pieces, or canes, then stacked onto a steel plate to be heated and fused to a hot bullet of glass to introduce a network of filigree patterns. Alternatively, glass bits can be prepared as murine, richly colored cross sections of glass. The artist selects and arranges his pattern of murine, heats it, then rolls it to another glass cylinder, picking up layers of bright color and graphic shapes to work with. Using canes or murine allows the glass worker to introduce infinite complex patterns of color, light, and geometry into a piece. From lacy spider webs and bold fractal twists to dense blocks of psychedelic color, stars, rhomboids, flowers, spirals, and waves. Lino was a quietly demanding teacher, serious about glass, and serious about his work ethic. But he was also generous about sharing all he knew.
I realized a huge difference between Venice, Murano here is we talk. We need to talk with the students. If you don't talk with the student, you are a great teacher. But if you don't talk with the student, it doesn't work.
In teaching, Lino found a second passion and vocation.
He changed everything for youngsters like myself. Total game changer. He showed us what is possible. And a formal language is really the best way I can describe what it is that he's imparted to us. More than artistry or discipline or anything else, it's like a language.
But if Lino's impact on students was profound, they made an impression on him too. Kids at Pilchuck were blowing glass for the sheer joy and fascination of it. Their energy inspired him. So did their fearless approach to new ideas. After that first summer, Tagliapietra began to take vacation time off from his successful career in Murano to spend regular time at Pilchuck. In doing so, Lino was able to build on the lessons he taught the previous summer and to continue to instill his rigorous work ethic and respect for technique into the best new generation of glass artists coming up. His influence was timely and profound.
Lino was extremely important to the studio glass movement. The great glassblowers like Ben Moore and Dante Mariani, they owe much of what they can do to Lino. I mean, they each developed their own style, but it was a Venetian style of working that came from being around Lino. It just passed down from one generation to the other, and people love to work with Lino.
Everybody wants a piece of Lino. All glassblowers want to get next to him, and he's pretty good about it. He's been really generous with his time. He rewards people who are thoughtful and enthusiastic with what it is that, you know, he knows and can do. And he's really, literally has shaped an entire generation of studio glass people just by being himself. Not anything deliberate, just by everybody sitting up and taking notice. And the people who really pay attention flourish.
Io a Murano ero famoso, avevo un'ottima reputazione, però arrivato a un certo punto mi era difficile continuare a lavorare a Murano. E ho avuto l'opportunità di venire qua e credo che l'America mi ha cambiato la vita in modo radicale. In modo estremamente positivo e credo che ho trovato l'ambiente ideale negli Stati Uniti per poter esprimere me stesso.
Chihuly came up with this idea in the late 1980s he wanted to do something with Lino.
The Venetian series was radically different than anything I'd ever done. I remember after a couple of weeks of working with them, I had a shelf that I'd lined up the pieces, and I had to decide whether I was going to exhibit them or not, because they were so different than anything I had done. I had a show lined up in New York, and at the very last minute, I decided that I would change my plans and show the Venetians. So that's when I made the plunge. And every year for many years, Lino came to my studio and we worked on the Venetians.
Dale was drawing pictures of these coils and a flower and a this and a that. Nobody could have pulled that stuff off. You know, it really was, in a sense, a collaboration. I mean, they're Dale's works, but Lino brought so much in that he was capable of pulling off these crazy drawings that Dale made. They together created, I just think, some of the most magnificent. I think it was one of the greatest periods in studio glass history, those two guys working together. And just the ability to pull that off and the huge team, Lino conducting, like 14 people on the team making these things, and loud music playing and everybody just grooving. It was a really cool thing. It if you watch Lino and the team blow glass together, you'll notice that very few words are spoken, a hand gesture here or there. There'll be a little bit of conversation about critical moments or the general direction of the piece, colors, that sort of thing. But not a lot of talking going on during the making of the piece.
Lino has usually, I think, 6 or 7, 8 people on his crew. What was incredible is that he would blow glass all morning, and about a half an hour before we were gonna quit for lunch, he'd go up and get the pasta started, and then go down and finish a piece, go upstairs, make the sauce. Then we'd have about a dozen people in the kitchen and we'd have lunch.
Fatto egoistico. Allora ho imparato un pochino a cucinare e a fare così. Però è un fatto culturale. Ho parecchi libri di cucina. Mi piace molto, anche se mi piacciono le cose molto semplici.
And then later, when he was working in Seattle, he would blow glass all day. Then he would go to the market, buy all the food for dinner that night, and then carry that food to some collector's house, and then cook dinner. That's an incredible amount of energy. Glassblowing's hard work. To go from working all day, and then go to the market, and then he'd be putting out food for 20 people. That had a lot to do with him learning English. And people really got to know him. To know him is to love him.
He cares about people. He looks after people that are close to him. He's genuinely concerned about the well-being of all the people that work with him and his friends and, you know, larger circle. Just an all-around good dude.
In Murano throughout the 1960s, 70s, and 80s, Lino oversaw artistic direction and production of beautiful chandeliers, goblets, vases, and other objects.
L'oggetto piccolo mi affascina, lo adoro. L'oggetto piccolo è un materiale da tenere in mano, da godere in mano, toccare, no? E mi permette anche di tenere una mano leggera.
The making of the goblet is, a lot of glassblowers will describe that as playing the scales. Lino did that on a production level where they had to make hundreds of these things for big orders, for diplomats, or for production wear.
The focus in these factories, production, technique, reproducibility, and accuracy.
In effetti io ho avuto la prima firma con grande arrabbiatura del titolare della fabbrica a 1000 anni del vetro, Palazzo Grassi, Venezia, nell'81. Prima, mai. E quello per me è stata una conquista.
In 1986, Lino reached an age where he could retire from production life and collect his pension after 43 years in Murano's factories. But kicking back, playing bocce, spending time with the grandkids, is not in his DNA. Remember, this is a man who spent vacations from the glass factory in Italy, teaching glass in America. When the factory door closed behind him, he went to work as usual, reinventing himself yet again as an independent glass artist. It was a transitional time, a dark period, as he recalled it later, trying to find his artistic footing. After years of production output, Lino was challenged to find expression of his own. Then, in 1996, in an afternoon at Pilchuck, a remarkable breakthrough occurred.
Lino was up there and he was teaching a class with his brother-in-law, Keiko Angoro. And this aha moment happened up there. Keiko was making a traditional Vanini leaf pattern, and there's this moment where they take it and they fold the bubble and change the axis a little bit. And then they attach a punty to the bottom side of that, and Keiko goes on to trim it and make this beautiful leaf pattern. There was a moment where you could see Lino's wheels spinning, and the next time he had the bench, he took that same technique with a beautiful cane pattern, and instead of attaching a punty to the bottom side and finishing a plate, he reattached another blowpipe, which created a whole new separate pattern that hadn't been done before. That technique came on to be known as Pilchuck 96, which he developed further at Pilchuck the following summer in 1996.
It was a personal renaissance for Tagliapietra at age 62.
He just sort of blossomed. Specifically around 1996, I really started to note that he made really, really original works.
In the 20 years since, Tagliapietra's work has exploded creatively. He's used classic Italian techniques in innovative new ways.
He had kind of a breakout show at Traver Gallery, and Lino had this display of goblets, but unbelievably done. It was not the traditional Venetian goblet. They were spectacular stems and bowls and feet that were these artistic compositions that he had designed. So you'd walk into the gallery and there was maybe a half a dozen of these. Then back through the rest of the gallery, there were some of these new pieces that were, instead of being based on functional wear or lighting wear or anything, were just purely functional forms, figurative vessels that were shaped like a female figure, and intricate cutting where he'd sent these pieces back to Venice and had surface embellishment done on it. And I worked with him on several of the pieces in the show and been on the team for a lot of that work. And when I walked into the gallery, my jaw dropped. I couldn't believe at how different and how beautiful this whole body of work was. It was amazing, it was inspiring, it was cataclysmic shift in the way we kind of thought about doing things and what could be done.
Lino, I don't know what makes him so extraordinary, really. I can't explain it, but he just had the golden hands. You know, he could make anything.
He's experimented with scale, with his long-necked dinosaurs and dramatic angel tears, worked in influences from his extensive global travels, capturing textiles, patterns, tribal motifs in glass. References to his beloved Venice find a place in his work, from a gondola-like series of vessels suspended on thin lines to wavy patterns that give an optical impression of looking out at the lagoon from a factory window. For some pieces, he's worked with a trusted team in Murano to change the quality of his finished pieces by adding dramatic cuts and bold textures to the surfaces, a process called cold working.
Cold working is the process where after the piece is blown and finished and annealed, different things can be achieved through the use of grinding and polishing wheels, stone and diamond and silicon carbide abrasives. Lino uses traditional Venetian cold working techniques to create surface embellishment and pattern in the glass. Things such as battuto, which creates a look that looks like hand-hammered copper. A technique called inciso, where they use a diamond V-shaped wheel to create little lines and grooves in the glass.
In cold working, the artist specifies the type and placement of the cuts, from lightly incised lines that give texture and accent to a piece, to heavily worked and polished cuts that define it.
And he uses that to weave in and out of the graphics that are created in the hot shop. And that is really a great way to not only change the pattern of the glass, but to break up the surface a little bit. A lot of the objects that have heavy cold working on them start to feel less glassy in a way. and more sculptural.
Lino is interested in glass working of all kinds, pushing his expertise beyond blown glass to explore two-dimensional work, bold, flat glass panels made from thick slices of colored murina.
You know, he's just really, really pushed it and experimented more than anybody else has. He's has this knowledge of how color's made and how colors work together. I don't mean how they look together, but like their working qualities and stuff like that. And the only way to garner that type of knowledge is through experience. Nobody has as much experience in a glassblowing studio as that dude does.
In the late 90s, he began a groundbreaking series of flat-worked panels.
My dream is to be painting. 1998. E abbiamo fatto I primi grandi pannelli, e ne abbiamo fatto di bellissimi.
Each panel is a mosaic made up of cane lengths and slices of murine fused together to form a flat surface. The result is a stunning composition, painterly in nature, while still preserving the qualities of glass, enabling light to shine through.
No, è un media che mi piace molto, è un media però che ci vuole tempo, molto costoso se vogliamo. Devi avere un supporto tecnico perché non è facile. Devo dirlo in questo, perché è una grande verità. E loro, attraverso errori fatti come tutti, qual è il problema? E in gran parte l'hanno risolto. E questo è veramente importante perché testimonia il fatto che se tu non fai errori non cresci. E per me avrei tantissimo desiderio veramente di fare pannelli ancora. Adesso, per esempio, è un sogno che vorrei realizzare. Ho dei pannelli in testa che sono legati a una filosofia dell'America del Sud, degli Stati Uniti, cioè d'Alabama. Cioè, Alabama ho visto dei tessuti, dei dipinti, ma soprattutto dei quilting, dei schiavi neri d'America che hanno fatto dei quilting che sono delle opere d'arte meravigliose, no? E secondo me, ispirandomi a questi, mi piacerebbe tantissimo a fare degli Alabama panel.
Where do his ideas come from? From his travels, certainly. From being open and curious about the world. And from a lifetime of being responsive to what's inherent in the material, what it wants to become. Though Lino lays out his colors beforehand and has an idea of the end in mind, no sketches are made in advance. Instead, working fluidly, quite literally in the heat of the moment, the artist makes his decisions spontaneously, drawing on 7 decades of technique to serve him well. Lino's avventurine pieces, for example, shimmer with beauty, belying the process to create them, which is fraught with challenge.
Perché avventurina? Perché viene da avventura, adventure. Per avventura dove che non si sa mai che tipo di vetro che fuori, che qualità.
Avventurine dates back to the first half of the 17th century, when Venetian glassblowers first began introducing copper microbits into their molten batches. The pieces that result from the adventurous process of making the glass sparkle with tiny pieces of gold, copper and other oxide crystals inside.
Cioè tu devi fare questo crogiolo, devi mettere tutte queste pozioni magiche che così la devi mescolare, devi trovare la giusta temperatura. Quando pensi che il vetro sia pronto, devi spegnerlo, bloccare, diciamo che non ci sia ossigeno, ma che ci sia, deve chiuso e deve riposare fino a che diventa freddo, poi devi rompere il crogiolo e solo dopo scopri quello che hai. Qualche volta viene bene e qualche volta no. Cioè veramente è un materiale che io odio e adoro.
In 2012, Tagliapietra was chosen for the prestigious Phoenix Award, the glass industry's Oscar. And as accolades have piled up, so have invitations to teach and exhibit from Brazil to Turkey, Australia to the Netherlands. Still, there are two places that tug at Lino's heart, the one he discovered in America and the one he left a long time ago. In Murano, tradition, family, and secrets run deep.
You know, I think vi credo che a Murano c'è stato proprio in qualche modo un certo momento, diciamo negli anni 90 circa. Non è stato visto con favore l'idea che io sia andato via da Murano.
Lino viewed sharing the techniques he'd learned as a way of keeping the noble tradition of glass evolving and alive. The Muranese saw him as a traitor.
La tecnica che hai imparato non è tua, ma degli antichi muranesi che ti hanno permesso di crescere, di arrivare a questa storia.
They resented his generosity and, no doubt, his growing influence and fame. For years, he was shunned by the community he called home. With time, however, the old resentments have cooled as Muranese recognize that what's good for glass is good for them.
If there's one thing that's going to save Venice in the long run, and one thing that's going to save Murano and the glass system there, it's the Venetians looking outward instead of inward. And so I think Lino's actually created that legacy where if there's a chance to change, it's because of him stepping outside of that system and outside of that society.
Today, as Lino and Lina walk the neighborhoods of Murano to the museum they are building on the island, they are greeted with genuine affection and respect.
I think what Lino's doing in Venice by building a museum and trying to help with something getting started there is really his gift back to Murano. Certainly Lino's given a lot to Murano, but also taken a lot too.
Murano is home, though they live in Seattle as well.
Murano è Murano, dunque, è difficile lasciare, no?
I feel in sometimes in Seattle, and the people work in Seattle, they are more Venetian than Venetian.
Yeah, and quando sei a Seattle, ci manca Murano. Parlo che per mia moglie. Quando siamo in Murano, ci manca Seattle.
I think that Seattle in two words. Seattle actually is more alive than Murano.
But in truth, home for Lino is at the bench.
So Lino, being from Venice, doesn't drive. And when he would come over to the States, I'd spend time, hours in the car with him, driving around. And we'd talk a lot about different subjects, religion definitely being one of those. And in one particular conversation, the idea of church came up. Being Italian, he was raised Roman Catholic and is still somewhat involved in the church on Murano. And I was asking him one day, I said, Lino, you going to church today? And he says, Kylie, you and me, we have a different church. And he meant in no way disrespect to the cathedrals or to the religion, but his point was he is most connected to that part of him when he's in the studio working, and he's most at peace and without noise than when he's in the studio. That's his church.
In real ways, in daily ways, glass is life for Lino Tagliapietra. 60 plus years of physically demanding labor notwithstanding, Lino still shows up for work every day.
Lino's 82, and he's still working. It's very unusual. And not only is he still working, he's making great work. And it shows no sign of stopping.
He continues to be fascinated with the possibilities that fire and this molten substance can yield.
Credo che bisogna avere sempre dentro di sé il senso del limite. And then you must have control the material. Tu devi controllare la materia, devi rispettare la materia e ascoltare, avere un dialogo con la materia. Non solo rispettare, ma anche avere un dialogo con la materia. Perché la materia ti può e ti suggerisce sempre qualcosa di diverso.
He works prolifically, challenging himself to keep raising the bar.
This year it worked very, very well. I think it's a great time because it's a wonderful job. I'm feeling very comfortable. I'm feeling also the quality glass, and then the result is quite good.
To keep pushing the bounds in his 80s, to see what both the material and the man can do. Rigor, discipline, technique, fused with curiosity, creativity, joy. Lino Tagliapietra stands alone at the forefront of his art.
I think Lino's at that stage in his career and his life where he's making objects that are technically, physically, and aesthetically forces to be reckoned with and objects to be remembered historically. Lino's legacy is going to far transcend the things that he's made. Lino's legacy is a change in philosophy worldwide with how generations of people think about what they do and how they make the artwork they're compelled to make.
What's next? It's still taking shape in the furnace of the Maestro.
I lavori che ho fatto nel passato sono importanti, però a me piace guardare sempre il futuro, nuove idee, nuove sperimentazioni, nuove ricerche. Mi piace molto cercare i nuovi limiti. L'ispirazione esiste, però devi cercarla, crearla, realizzarla, che è la parte più difficile. È la parte però che mi piace di più.